This nation has a rich heritage of success stories, rags to riches parables. Poor boy from the backlands makes good in the big city. But there's a special niche for such stories about men whose dogged determination to succeed enabled them to overcome one agonizing defeat after another. Paul Galvin is such a man, and this is his story. Paul Galvin was born on June 29, 1895, in Harvard, Illinois, a small town not far from the Wisconsin state line. Harvard, at the turn of the century, was just another farm community with muddy roads and a few scattered buildings. Paul's father, an Irishman named John Galvin, had given up farming to buy and operate a saloon in town. Paul's mother, Alice Brickley Galvin, was of sturdy pioneer stock, wise to the rugged life, yet a devoted wife and mother. As Paul Galvin once recalled of his early days in Harvard,
"The man of the house worked through the day, came home, ate supper, and afterwards went uptown to the tobacco shop or newsstand where he cronied with his friends. There were things we did as a family, too, like, well, in the summertime we eagerly awaited the circus coming to town. And I think we're among the first to have a phonograph. We also had a player piano and would pump it to get Sweet Adeline or some song of the day."
Among the family members were Paul's brothers, Joe on the right and Raymond on the left, who was nicknamed Burley. Standing behind this trio is their father. Youngest of the five Galvin children were Philip, who died a young man, and Helen. When Galvin was 11, he began his first job, stripping the stems from large tobacco leaves for a small tobacco factory in Harvard. He was paid $2 a week during his 2 summers on the job, working 11 hours a day, 6 days a week. But Galvin credited his early interest in the business world to a teacher he had in grammar school.
"Her interest stimulated me into looking around for an opportunity to enter business. About this time, I observed a couple of brothers at the train station selling popcorn, so I projected myself into this business, experiencing for the first time the struggle of free enterprise. I would pop the corn on our cook stove at home, and I advertised hot buttered popcorn. My brothers, Burley and Joe, worked with me as the business grew."
But fate one day stepped in to block young Galvin's bid for modest success. A rival popcorn salesman fell under the wheels of a train and was nearly killed, causing the railroad men to put a stop to all popcorn sales. In later years, Galvin would retell this story to make a point to associates when some product or market was on its way out.
"Recognize the signs. If you're going to take a licking, take it and get on to the next job."
With the notion of operating his own business temporarily put aside, Galvin concentrated on his schoolwork. In his senior year of high school, he was captain of the football team, played basketball, and was vice president of the school athletic association. He was an organizer of the school's literary society, and even tried his hand at acting. After graduation, in the fall of 1913, Galvin left home to enroll as a student at the University of Illinois in Urbana. The money he had saved from the popcorn business was quickly spent, so he took whatever part-time jobs he could find, setting up pins in a bowling alley and distributing handbills for a local cleaners. Meanwhile, here at the family's home in Harvard, there was a real financial dilemma. Harvard had voted to go dry, forcing Galvin's father to close the saloon, sell their home, and buy farmland in Wisconsin. But the land turned out to be worthless. Returning to Harvard at school's end, Galvin worked as a mail carrier during the summer months. He returned to Urbana in the fall, but could no longer concentrate on his studies.
"I just went as far as I could. I cleaned out all my belongings, and when I went home to Harvard in the spring, I told my family I just gave it up."
Back in Harvard, he went to work at the railroad station as a clerk. but he tired of the job and went to Chicago, where he took a job as a clerk for the Commonwealth Edison Company. While at Commonwealth Edison, Galvin learned of a new Army officers' training program at nearby Fort Sheridan. His 2-year college education qualified him for entrance, so he enlisted. In an early letter home to his father, he wrote,
"I never thought I would like this work as much as I do, but it gives me the science of the game. There's the necessity of absolute coordination between artillery and infantry, which can only be brought about by highly organized communications."
Galvin eventually became an artillery officer and saw duty on the front lines in France during World War I. His wartime experiences strengthened his faith in the virtues of a well-disciplined organization, able to withstand crisis through mutual loyalty and a leader's concern for his men. After the war, in 1920, Galvin married his childhood sweetheart, Lillian. Theirs was to be a good marriage, because Lillian understood Paul's ambition, his dream to make a place for himself in business, and she wanted and was willing to help him achieve it. As Galvin told his son, Bob, about those early years,
"Edward Stewart and myself started a storage battery company on July 15, 1921, in Marshfield, Wisconsin.
The plant soon began producing about 150 storage batteries a day, and Paul's brother, Joe, joined the company team. Of Joe and the new business, Paul once wrote,
"Joe has been on the job right with me, a big help, and he is also dog-tired every night. I have been buried, and I am just now getting my head above water. It's been a tough pull night and day, 6 a.m. to 11 p.m., including Sunday. But all our effort was doomed to failure as the country began to feel the effects of the 1920-21 Depression, and the Marshfield location turned out to be a poor one because it was too far away from any central shipping point."
However, Galvin held on to the business through 1923, when Lillian gave birth to the couple's only son, Robert. Soon after, however, the business was padlocked shut by government agents for non-payment of excise taxes. So Galvin, with only $1.50 in his pocket, packed up his family and drove them back to Chicago. He was disheartened over losing the business, but his spirit was never broken.
In Chicago, I took a job with the Brock Candy Company for 3 years, working as personal secretary to Emil Brock. I learned that hard work alone is not enough unless it's tempered and guided by direction and good sense. With this new business experience, I once again entered the storage battery business through a chance meeting with my ex-partner, Ed Stewart. This time, however, we located the plant in Chicago.
However, now it was Galvin's product, the battery, that was the big business question mark. Battery-operated radios were almost a thing of the past. Alternating current radios were the up-and-coming fad, so Galvin hurriedly went to work on an idea whereby the old battery-operated radios could be used with electric current. His idea spawned what was called the battery eliminator.
But creditors forced me to close the business before I could get the battery eliminator on the market.
So, at the suggestion of the Sears Roebuck Company, Galvin raised $1,000 and used most of it to buy back the eliminator portion of the business at a public auction of his old plans and equipment. The Galvin Manufacturing Corporation was then born on September 25th, 1928, in a small section of a rented building at 847 Harrison Street in Chicago. The corporation had 5 employees. There, Galvin invaded the home radio field by manufacturing some alternating current sets with 9 tubes and assorted nameplates for resale under various brand names. Business was picking up, and the company was beginning to turn a modest profit when once again catastrophe struck. This time, it was the stock market crash of 1929. The big manufacturers began dumping their radio sets on the market at prices well under cost.
They all had to scramble. They went to the customer who had been buying our private brands and sold him sets at half what he'd been buying our sets for. Maybe it helped reduce the inventory of the big fellas, but it sure didn't help the small manufacturer like myself.
By Christmas of 1929, Galvin was just about out of business again. And to add to this, his father had died October 8th at the age of 63. Shortly after, Galvin's mother died at the age of 58. Then fate, as Galvin later recalled, began to smile.
While on a business trip to New York, I learned about a couple of fellows who were installing radios in automobiles, a feat almost unheard of in those early days. The idea sparked me into thinking I could do the same.
So Galvin and his crew began work on the car radio project. Typical of their early problems was finding a place to install the bulky receiver, batteries, and speaker. With a lot of hard work and a little bit of luck, Galvin and his men overcame these problems, and their first radio was installed in Galvin's car in time for him to drive to the Radio Manufacturers Association convention in June of 1930. News of Galvin's invention spread, and the idea began to catch on. With each installation, Galvin's engineers and servicemen learned answers to problems by trial and error. And the Motorola trademark in those first years earned the reputation of America's finest car radio. The original model 5T71 auto radio that Galvin took to Atlantic City established one of many Motorola firsts. This model has justifiably been called the first commercial auto radio. Also, in 1930, the name Motorola was conceived. The name came to Galvin one morning while shaving. The name suggested both motion and radio, and Galvin thought it striking and effective.
By 1934, Motorola radios had come a long way in terms of performance and excellence. They incorporated everything we learned about auto radio through 6 years of trial and error.
Another reason for the success and growth of Galvin's Motorola products was the company's affiliation with the B.F. Goodrich Company and independent distributorships. Through their hundreds of branch stores, the name Motorola became both well-known and trusted. At about this same time, Motorola began its first real advertising campaign, part of which included erecting hundreds of billboards along the nation's highways. This advertising produced one highly unexpected result when Florida Seminole Indians, for a short time, used these heavy steel signs as flooring for their homes. Yes, Paul Galvin and Motorola were on their way to modest success. Employment at the plant was increasing, and Galvin was developing into a seasoned leader and businessman. One employee said, "Mr. Galvin could be stern, not cutting you piece by piece, but letting go a blast like an explosion that struck you all at once and left your eyebrows singed and your senses rattled." Or Galvin could be compassionate with his employees. Once, hearing of an illness in an employee's family, he called the man and said,
"Are you sure you have the best doctor? If there's any question, I know the best physician for that, and I'll be happy to call him for you."
Then Galvin secretly paid the bill himself. Another example of Galvin's early generosity concerned bonuses and what was then relatively new, a stock option retirement plan.
"I don't want you fellas to spend a lifetime with me and be dependent on salary alone. I hope we can build an equity in the company for you and your families so that you can look forward to retirement."
By 1936, Motorola had outgrown its facilities at the Harrison Street plant, and Galvin bought land on Augusta Boulevard in Chicago, where he built a new, modern plant. In 1938, some of the first of many Motorola employee organizations were formed. The most important of these was the Service Club, which brought together the 10-year veterans who had begun with Galvin in 1928. In 1940, Motorola went to war. On a tip from a newspaper friend, Galvin learned that the Army was being hampered by a lack of effective radio communications. So, Motorola engineers were assigned to lick the problem. Their answer was this now famous unit, the Handy Talkie. During the war, nearly 40,000 of these units were made for various branches of the service. This renowned walkie-talkie was also a creation of Motorola, under the guidance of Dr. Daniel Noble. More than 50,000 of these units were manufactured for World War II, earning Motorola 5 Army-Navy awards for excellence. And it was during those crucial war years that the radio industry itself turned to Galvin for leadership. The Radio Manufacturers Association elected Paul Galvin its president. In accepting the coveted position, Galvin had this to say.
Problems are not new to us in this industry. We've always had them, and we will always have them. Great or small, they must be answered. Maybe not to our entire satisfaction, but somehow answered. Let us keep our mental feet on the ground. Be calm and use foresight.
An example of meeting an industry problem came none too soon. With the stepped-up need for military communications equipment, the industry needed much more than the 50 to 75,000 quartz crystals a year it had been manufacturing. So it was Motorola, under the guidance of Galvin and Elmer Wavering, who went to work on the problem. By the end of 1943, Motorola was supplying 200 to 250,000 crystals a week. And by the end of the war, Motorola had furnished almost 35 million crystals, more than half of all used in the entire war effort. The war years also brought personal tragedy to Galvin. In 1942, his wife Lillian was found slain in the family's home, a victim of an apparent robbery attempt. And in 1944, Paul's faithful and hard-working brother, Joe, on the right here, died of an apparent heart attack at the age of 45. After the war, Galvin reserved his most enthusiastic anticipation for television. The 10-inch television set introduced by RCA had become a standard of the industry, selling for under $300. Galvin, however, set about to produce a set of comparable or better quality for a lower price. He did it with this model VT71 7-inch screen set, priced at only $179.95. Not all of Motorola's war and post-war projects were to fare as well as television, however. For example, there was this gasoline burner automobile heater, which turned out to be a costly mistake. But Galvin did not brood about mistakes. He was candid to admit,
when we make one, it's a whopper. Perhaps the biggest coup I engineered in the post-war years was my association with one of the world's largest automobile manufacturers, the Ford Motor Company. The Detrola Company, which had been producing radios exclusively for the Ford Company, was losing money. I bought out Detrola lock, stock, and barrel, and wound up producing 50% of all car radios for not only the Ford Company, but for Chrysler, too. And we produced 100% of all radios used by American Motors.
All this time, Galvin did not neglect his obligations to the community outside of the company. He served as a member of the board of directors of the Evanston Hospital, Marillac House, and was a member of the President's Council at Loyola University. In 1951, Galvin received an honorary Doctor of Laws degree from Loyola University. Pope Pius XII designated him a Knight of Malta and a Knight of St. Gregory, two of the highest awards that can be presented a Catholic layman. And in 1956, the Electronics Industry Association voted him its Medal of Honor, the association's highest award for outstanding contributions to the industry. In awarding him the medal, the EIA president said, "Few men have the vitality and capacity that have enabled Paul Galvin to devote so much time to activities of broad industry interest, while at the same time building up a business from scratch to a multi-million dollar corporation. Yet, he never seems hurried or harried. In the fall of 1944, Galvin met Virginia Critchfield, a secretary in his physician's office. A year later, on November 21st, 1945, they were married. A new and lasting happiness had entered his life. Fourteen years later, at the age of 64, Paul Galvin died, a victim of leukemia. His wife Virginia and son Bob, his sister Helen, and brother Burley were at his bedside on that November 5th in 1959. But does a man like Paul Galvin really ever die? Is death so final that nothing of the man lingers on? Here's the proposed new corporate office building for Motorola in Schaumburg, Illinois, and the communications division, also in Schaumburg. Here's Motorola in Puerto Rico, Motorola in Pontiac, Illinois, and here's Motorola's sprawling facilities in Austin, Texas, and in Scottsdale, Arizona, and more. No, Paul Galvin lives on. Motorola is Paul Galvin. Wherever so many of us turn, Paul Galvin is there. Perhaps better than anyone else, Galvin captured the essence of his own life in a commencement address he delivered in 1953 before the graduates of Loyola University. He said,
"Do not fear mistakes. Wisdom is often born of such mistakes. You will know failure. Determine how to acquire the confidence required to overcome it. Reach out."
Thank you.